People I always ask, are those birds? Wow, wow, all the screaming, and it's all the singer. Just, it's the end of the track and she's laughing. And it's, you know, pitch super high, but it's a singer, yeah. Hi, this is Cristo. Welcome to my studio. This is The Breakdown, and today we're breaking down the White Lotus theme, Renaissance. So here we are up north of Montreal. This is the Laurentians. It's pretty rural. I don't have neighbors really. So we're in the woods. I'm a city person normally, but maybe 10 or 7 years ago, I started coming here and renting places and working in nature, and it felt great. I felt more focused, and I just really love being in nature. Now I've been living here. I bought this place. I've become a caveman, I suppose. I just really love working in the woods and sometimes going into the city, getting the vibe, but then walking away and coming back here so I can really concentrate on nature and music mainly. I grew up going to the countryside with nature in Chile, which is very different from here, but still, I was always very attracted to the sounds, any sounds that animals make, and birds in particular. Here you get a big amount of a fascinating range of birds, and there is one particular bird that I really love. It's the hermit thrush. People call it the genius musician bird because it does all these arpeggios and amazing melodies. It's like it goes into these figures, and then it answers itself, and it's very fast, but when you record it and you slow it down, you can hear all the notes as if it's a symphony, and slow it down. For us, we are so slow humans, we can grab the notes when it's pitched down, and it really feels like, and it goes like that. And it's just crazy because it feels like an incredible composition. And it's always evolving, so it's kind of jazzy at the same time. So I kind of experiment recording all kind of sounds. I suppose it does influence me a lot, even when I'm not doing crazy sounds or recording animals or anything like that. But it does influence me in the same way that, you know, studying classical music did influence me, although I'm not, you know, using it in a conscious way, because I'm not making classical music, but it's all there. So I suppose it's all part of the palette. So season one was a bit of a rush because they called me very late, and I had maybe about a month. I had one conversation with Mike, and after that I was on my own jamming in my studio with everything that I had there, all the percussions, the flutes and whatnot. I went straight for percussions and tribal sounds. It's all very instinctive at that point, because we didn't have much time. I went with what I felt about the script and about my conversation with Mike. And it felt like I did have to somehow be savage about the music, going into tribal sounds, percussions, and all that. With time, I started realizing why I went into that, because it's not about Hawaii, about local music. It's not about anything like that. It just feels like, somehow the tourists could be savages. You could be confused because it's like tourists get into a wild place and this is a vibe. You hear animals and tribal things and whatnot. But maybe the music is not about Hawaii. Maybe it's not about, it's about these people that are acting like savages. Maybe the music is mocking them sometimes. I suppose there's so many things that could be happening, but I wasn't really thinking about that, like making plans about that, because like I said, we didn't have time. So all of this stuff, it somehow started making sense afterwards. And they did like the music. In the end, I started sending this stuff and for the mix and whatnot. And luckily it did work, because if it didn't, then we didn't have the time for me to do another score or anything like that. So yeah, we were lucky. And Mike was into it, I think, at the beginning. Although I think the editor, Heather Persons, she helped a lot making things happen. Like, for example, the first season's theme is pretty, it felt pretty radical compared to what they were thinking initially. Like they had this track, this temp track with these images for the theme, for the titles sequence. And it was very loungy. It was very soft, sexy. And then, you know, I send this stuff that it's, you know, people screaming and suffocating and all of that stuff. So it wasn't the easiest proposition. But happily it did work out, and interestingly the feedback from people reflected that I heard lots of people saying that they felt anxious about the show, about the music, tense and whatnot, but they still like it, and they can't stop listening to it, and this and that. So it's, I think it's an interesting thing that you can somehow push people a little bit, and they still appreciate that and getting to into that beat. So yeah, that's it's a bit chaotic for me to try to remember how this happened, because it was very fast, but it's something like that. there were some schedule conflicts for me, so I had several projects going on, and I thought I couldn't do the second season. So we told them that. They asked if I could at least do the theme, so do an adaptation to this new location. And Mike wanted to have some little, you know, Renaissance elements, vibes, Italian opera, and this and that. So I went straight for certain sounds that are just cliché sounds, the little harp and a little opera. I was trying to do an intro that is not like the first season, that is something completely, it has nothing to do. So it's like a mock-up of some kind of Italian opera or something like that, that evokes an Italian vibe. So once I had this intro with this strings, harp, the goal was to get into somehow the theme, what we recognize as the White Lotus theme, which for me is the voices. So those voices, those ululu, ululating voices, or whatever you call them, we start building from scratch from that moment until the end. And then I tried to keep some elements from the Italian intro into this, and they start disappearing until we get to this club anthem. So at that point, I guess we were at, you know, some kind of after hours partying. We're not anymore at these ruins with somebody playing the harp, you know, in a nice shot or something like that. And we go into this, you know, club beat. The thing is that I did that really fast, and I couldn't send it to Mike because I was tripping when I did it. But afterwards, I started thinking about the sounds, about the production and this and that. And I started criticizing, and I thought, okay, this is not very good. I need to change this, it sounds too clean or whatever. And for some reason, I just hit it and I never sent it. And it took me maybe a month And I thought I was not going to send it and just forget about it. But then for some reason, I thought, whatever, I just I'm gonna send it this to Mike and see what happens. And they loved it. And I received an email back and it was perfect for them and all of that. So I was really surprised. And then, you know, I somehow started appreciating this theme again. And I realized, you know, when this came out and it became such a big thing, and there's, you know, Tiësto doing a remix and it's all over the place, I realized that this is something I'm still learning, is that, you know, you do something really fast and your feeling is right. You have this gut feeling that this is, you're tripping, you're dancing and blah, blah. But this is a very short moment. And then afterwards, when you start criticizing, and if you take the time to perfect it and start betterizing or whatever, then it's like you start strangling the tune somehow. And it starts, you start losing elements. You think it's better. For example, if I say I would prefer, you know, a dirty beat instead of this, you know, super clean kick, whatever. But these are ideas that it doesn't mean much, I realize. And when I see people tripping, I thought, maybe it's great that I didn't touch this track at all. I didn't make it better, because maybe it would be lifeless if I did. I don't know if I can even take credit for this track in a way, because it's so fast. It's something like this, and then you become somebody else. It's like you go into a place, and you do something, and then it takes a life of its own, and it's somehow you have to let it live and see what happens. But this, I think it takes a long time to get to a point where you can let stuff live and just, you know, not try to perfect everything. And I'm just wrong to even judge what I did. So, but anyhow, I'm happy it went out and, you know, into the world, and it has a life now. So do you see the wave happening there? So this is the whole recording, which is a bit higher than this, something like that. So this is the whole track. And that, now she's talking there. So I put the whole track without edits. So she's laughing and she's talking in between and all that. I put this in the sampler. This is Stephanie Osorio. She lives in Montreal, but she's from Colombia. And I asked her to do this for one long note like this one you see here. So she did that. And so this whole chunk I put into a sampler that I can play here. And then I'm playing the notes with the pitch wheel, which in this case is this ribbon here, which you use to change the pitch, like this. So normally you will tend to play the notes like on a keyboard, but here it sounds a little bit, a little wavy, and I didn't like that. So I did it with the ribbon here instead, like this. So as you can hear, it's all off tune and everything, because I don't know what I'm doing here. You see, it's a very little space. So I had to put tapes and tape here, and then I tape here until the pitch sounds right to me. So I somehow need to practice this to get it right. But the thing is, by doing it this way with the random pitch, is that every time I'm hitting a note, it's not exact, so it's closer to what a person would normally do. There's little details like that that I feel you can't really sing it. I mean, people, they know it, but when they try to sing it, it's like, it's kind of a little bit too hard to, it's not really human the way it's done, but it does feel very much like a person. It doesn't feel like auto-tune or a vocoder or a robotic thing or anything like that. It's very much like a very organic, just very weird person, I suppose, or creature. And to me, that's what's interesting about this. So if we listen to the harmonies, which keep building. Those are all mistakes by playing with the pitch. So all the little screams, the laughing in between the notes and all that stuff, to me, it makes the track a lot more interesting or more alive. And for me, that's what turns me on to work in something like that. And the rest, the beat and whatnot, it's almost like an afterthought in a way. You know, when you listen to sometimes Latin American pop or African pop, let's say you take a song from the radio from Zimbabwe or something like that, and you listen to the production, to me, I feel always refreshing that the sounds is like someone took a Yamaha keyboard and then went to some preset vibraphone or whatever, and that's it. That's a sound for this part, and then some other preset for this and that. And it's not like there's not a lot of research in the production. It's about the vibe, and lots of it come from the vocal and the writing in the music. So I suppose in a way I was working in that sense, where I'm not spending a week trying to do the right distortion, saturation, for the transient of the kick drum and stuff like that. This was really like, okay, this sound, this and that. And now I can concentrate on the vocals, which are making the, to me, is the structure, the journey of this song that is important, because this build-up with the club anthem and everything, it really is about the form more than anything that is happening at one particular moment. I wanted to feel like we're always reaching a new plateau, and even towards the end it becomes extreme. It's like every chord we hit seems like it's a new chord, but it's not. It's like the song could finish here, but it doesn't, and then it could finish here, but it doesn't. And so I was kind of chasing this energy. And to me, once again, it's all in the voices where that energy comes from. So to me, this sounds like some crazy robot. The intervals it's too large. And if it was a person, maybe, of course, a virtuoso would do this nice. But playing it like this, it just doesn't sound good. So I needed to stay in a small space for the intervals and to be able to play it here, like in two movements like this. And, so it's basically, it's like, okay, I like this. And that's it. I ended up with, na, 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 na. And then the other harmonies, which are, every harmony is different, but I don't even remember what's the first harmony we hear in the first theme. But I suppose I could have started with any of those melodies, and some of them sound like that, and some of them doesn't sound like that tune. But in any case, I felt maybe familiar with the. There's something about that that almost sounds like a Latin American, you know, dancey track. So in my mind, I never went to, okay, is this, you know, stuff from 200, a million years ago? If your knowledge is Metallica and you recognize something from Metallica here, that you could actually, because I do, I was a fan of Metallica, and then you're going to tell me, okay, you took this from Metallica, but this is just what you know. This is because you know that. So every person told me, okay, this band, did you take this from this Animals band or whatever? I don't even know that band. So I suppose you were jamming with what's within your head, and something comes out that is yours. And it's, I think that's how art works, because otherwise art will die if nobody took over something and make their own version and keep going into the future with that, then everything would die, right? So I suppose you just can jump with what's in your head and pick whatever is there. But this, it never came to my mind, that is eerie, you know, I'm gonna do some version of that because of the witches, because of Satan, or I don't know what. No, yeah, it wasn't like that. But once again, like I said before, you could be thinking about the funeral march. Dun, 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 dun. I mean, this is. Dun, 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 dun. I mean, if this is your culture, you would think of that. But if your culture is Star Wars, then you say, oh, he copied Star Wars. No, maybe not, you know? And anyways, it's Nirvana, so who cares? It's like. Yeah. So this sound, when you listen in solo, I don't know if you would think of this song when you listen to this like that, but if you listen to the track, I think that synth is one of the elements, one of the people working in the back that you don't even know they exist, but they're doing something so important. Emotionally for me, that slight bend in this synth is very dramatic. There's a certain darkness to it. It's one of the elements that make this not feel only like a club beat that everything is going well. Maybe, I think I'm trying to put this together right now. It's just a sound I like. So, it sounds somehow like a voice. It sounds like Blade Runner all of a sudden. But yeah. It's kind of scary actually when you listen alone, it's eerie. So you don't expect this to be in a cloud track, I suppose. Let's see what else is there. Every time I put something in solo, it feels like there's some really dramatic thing going on. It's weird because to me this track is something like you're just jumping around in a club, but I'm listening to this and it's like it's kind of almost sad or nostalgic. This is just a mellotron. It which is what the beetles use in strawberry fields, kind of flutes. And this is normally it's like a big instrument which has tapes in it, like, if you will, like cassettes. Every note is a tape that starts rolling, and you have this sound. So this is a boys' choir, and every note, it's just a tape, and there's the voices recorded there, and that's why it sounds. It has this texture which is kind of unreal, which is what I like for this at least. And these are some strings. The beat of the strings is only the docking from the kick, right? So the kick is taking away the strings. Every time it kicks, the strings go away and then they come back. So this is the classic sound of dance music, the pumping. So I took just one note like this. And the next one you see is another chunk. And it's just pitched, you know, I pitch blocks like this. I think I'm kind of realizing this while we're listening to this, how dramatic the elements are. And maybe this is why people connect with it. I'm not sure, but it could be that. Because the tune is not dark. There's some kind of euphoria going on. Maybe it's that. There's a darkness that comes with drugs. I suppose in there, you have a souvenir of being in a club really wasted. No, I don't know, but there's something weird in the sense that you don't think of this as a dark song, but the elements are dark. So I just discovered this now. Like, I did this show called Utopia, the British version, in it was one of the first time I was working this, and I think the music is really playful, to the point you could be thinking, why is a show about the end of, you know, the world maybe, has this playful music, like funny music. But it's kind of like this a little bit. If you start really listening, it's there's something dark going on in between the notes, in between the lines, I suppose. I love that Mike White leaves some things in the dark, and he doesn't answer all the questions that we have about the characters. And I mean, even at the end of the show, it's not clear what was actually going to happen before, you know, the big shooting happens. We didn't have proof who is really evil, you know, what's going on. So, and I kind of like that every character seems to switch from a place where, oh, I really like this person now, you know, and all of a sudden they do something that is really ugly. It's like, oh my God, just what is that? And it feels real. It feels like real people, real relations. It feels less like you know, superheroes, or I don't know. I really like the way he does that. Some painters have told me that people don't want to be painted the way they are, or the way the artists see it. They're going to criticize, yeah, but my nose, it doesn't really look like that, or something like that. Mm-hmm. You have a deformed vision that you want to be, you know, look a certain way. Sometimes artists can be really radical and, you know, paint something that... It feels good here, this opera.